So, we will be continuing now in English, if everybody would like to have a seat, with Rodrigo Hasbun. Did I pronounce it correctly?
Yep.
You can correct me.
I mean, in Spanish, we don't pronounce the H, so it's Rodrigo Hasbun. But I live in the U.S. and they pronounce it like
Hasbun. They pronounce it as well, but we'll pronounce it correctly this evening, Hasbun. Welcome. We're talking about the book of your life, the book that meant so much to you, that changed it, that influenced it. Which is your book of your life?
Oh, this was a very difficult task because it's not only one book that you love. And I think I tend to think more of writers than of books. So I have three or four writers that have been very important in my life. And I chose one of them. And the first book I read of his, he's called Roberto Bolaño. I don't know if you're familiar with his work. This is one of his masterpieces.
Mm-hmm. What's the title?
It's called The Savage Detectives.
The Savage Detectives.
And it's difficult to say where Bolaño is from because he was born in Chile, but he spent a lot of time in Mexico, and then he moved to Spain. And I think that's one of his strengths, and that's one of the things that makes him so interesting, that he's a transnational writer.
Yeah. Because that shapes the way that you look at the world? Or?
Yeah, because that's something big right now. And I think some of the most interesting writers are writers who have the transnational experience.
Yeah.
And I think it touches me in a special way because I'm also someone who has experienced life in different cities and in different countries.
Yeah, so let's start. Where were you born?
I was born in Cochabamba, Bolivia.
Bolivia. And then where did you go to?
And then I moved around a little bit. I spent some time in Chile. I spent some time in Spain, always going back to Bolivia. And then I spent some time in Ithaca, New York, which is a small town upstate New York. And then I moved to Toronto in Canada. And then I moved back to Ithaca. And now I'm finally in Houston, Texas.
So no borders for you?
No.
No. So let's talk about the book, The Savage Detectives. That sounds very promising. Detectives, savages, is it? What is it? What kind of book is it?
It's a difficult book to define. It's basically a story of these two young poets who are in search of an old poet. And the book covers like around 20 years, and it's basically the story of these two friends, and it's a book of about friendship, a book about time, and a book about the literary passion. So for me, this book was important, I think, because I read it in the perfect time. I was like around 18 or 19, and at the time, I already knew I wanted to become a writer, and everybody at that time told me, oh, you should go read Vargas Llosa, you should go read García Márquez, and like the big Latin American names, and that's what I very obediently did. And I read them, and I admired their books, but I didn't feel much. And then I was in Chile spending a vacation, and I happened to find this book in a very small book fair. I was very seduced by the title. I didn't know anything about the writer. The book was fairly cheap. I bought it. I started to read it, and it was immediately it broke my heart. It it taught me things about literature and also things about life. And I think the most powerful books do that.
Yeah.
They teach you, or they help you to see yourself in a different light.
Yeah.
They help you to see the people you have around you in a different light. But they also show you what literature is capable of. So I was immediately seduced, and I was like, oh, this guy, he's almost like a friend, and he's talking about my own experience. And I was 18 or 19. I was writing very passionately. Yeah. I was experiencing the joy of sex and joy of friendship.
Ooh, that's very tempting to start talking about the joy of sex. Did you realize that?
Yeah. He was talking about all these things. So mm-hmm. I was like, oh, this...
But you recognized it.
I recognized myself in the uh-huh. book, and I recognized the literary passion. And yeah. I felt he was talking about a Latin America I knew.
Yeah.
Not the Latin America of García Márquez, who was... I couldn't recognize myself or my city or my problems or my... political uneasiness in García Márquez, and I think it was all of that was here in The okay. Savage Detective.
So maybe it's a good time that you read the excerpt that you sure. want to read, so that we learn a bit what it's like.
I'm curious, how many of you have read this book?
Anybody? Yeah, oh, two people. Well, there you go. Because I didn't know the author, I'm going to be honest with
so,
you.
So, oh, no.
No.
Bolaño's not big here.
No. Me not knowing about him doesn't mean anything. So, yeah. But I didn't. So
oh, we can talk about Bolaño a little bit
yeah,
later.
Of course.
So these are the first pages. The book has three parts. The first and the third part are a journal of a young writer called Juan García Madero. He's 17. He's starting to write, and he's experiencing all these things. He's experiencing poetry. He's experiencing sex. He's experiencing getting drunk, and most of all, he's experiencing friendship, real friendship. And then the second part, which is the biggest part of the book, has perhaps 40 different narrators.
40? Wow.
Yeah, and it. Covers 20 years of the life of this group of poets, and we see them age, and we see them. Some of them die. Some of them get ill. Some of them leave the country. Some of them come back.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the journal of Juan García Madero. This
mm-hmm.
is how the book starts.
Okay.
November 2. I've been cordially invited to join the Visceral Realists. I accepted, of course. There was no initiation ceremony. It was better that way. November 3. I'm not really sure what visceral realism is. I'm 17 years old. My name is Juan García Madero, and I'm in my first semester of law school. I wanted to study literature, not law, but my uncle insisted, and in the end, I gave in. I'm an orphan, and someday I'll be a lawyer. That's what I told my aunt and uncle, and then I shut myself in my room and cried all night. Or anyway, for a long time. Then, as if it were settled, I started class in the law school's hollow halls. But a month later, I registered for Julio César Álamo's poetry workshop in the literature department. And that was how I met the visceral realists, or visceral realists, as they sometimes like to call themselves. Up until then, I had attended the workshop four times, and nothing ever happened. Though only in a manner of speaking, of course, since naturally something always happened. We read poems, and Álvaro praised them or tore them to pieces, depending on his mood. One person would read, Álamo would critique. Another person would read, Álamo would critique. Somebody else would read, Álamo would critique. Sometimes, Álamo would get bored and ask us, those of us who weren't reading just then, to critique too. And then he would critique, and Álamo would read the paper. It was the ideal method for ensuring that no one was friends with anyone, or else that our friendships were unhealthy and based on resentment.
So friendship is a very big.
Yeah, this is a very candid character
yeah.
who's discovering everything about life, and literature for him is also a war. No, a war against people mm-hmm. who write differently or people who conceive of literature as something different.
Yeah.
And then he meets these two poets, Arturo Velano and Ulises Lima, and he kind of falls in love with them and follows them.
Yeah, is literature war for you as well?
I think it's a war against myself. It's
mm-hmm.
a war of always... feeling I'm failing in my books and
uh-huh.
trying to write better books. And it's more an internal war
inner struggle.
Yep.
Yeah. So, and you said that you learned a lot from reading this book because you recognized a lot about your own world, the world surrounding you, your views. What did it teach you about yourself and about how you fit into, the place that you were at the time?
I think Bolaño was mostly a role model. He was a guy who...
The writer himself.
Mm-hmm. He struggled a lot. He started publishing only when he was 40. Mm-hmm. And until then, he had published... he had written many, many different novels and poems and short stories. He was rejected once and again until at 40. He got this... he started getting published and getting attention. And I think that his passion was very contagious. Mm-hmm. Later on, a few years after I read him for the first time, there was a very important literary festival in Latin America, mm-hmm. Where 39 writers, young writers, got together. And it was interesting to realize that most of them had Bolaño as a role model.
Really?
He was very sick. He found about this when he was 40. So he wrote like crazy. He wrote like maybe 20 books in the last 10 years of his life. Mm. And then he died. And he died before getting really well known. I mean, he was starting to being translated. And that was about it. And I think there was something very pure about his way of understanding literature that...
And as I hear you talk, he influenced the younger generation of writers, if I understand you correctly, much more than Gabriel García Márquez and his contemporaries.
Oh, yeah. I think García Márquez and Vargas Llosa were like our grandparents.
Uh-huh.
And that we don't pay that much attention to our grandparents. And mm-hmm. he was like the crazy uncle. Crazy uncle who traveled the world, who did all kind of little jobs to have time to write. And I think he was a real example. And you can feel in this book that he's enjoying himself while writing.
Yeah.
No, he's not a professional writer. He's someone who needs to do what he's doing. And I think that was incredibly important, at least for me when I was 18 or 19. Mm-hmm. And I think he showed me some...
Yeah, because did you follow in his footsteps? Did you decide to go and travel because he traveled? Did he inspire you in that way?
No, although as soon as I finished reading this book, I became an addict of his work, and uh-huh. I follow his work, and he was publishing, and I was trying to get the new books. And then I was thinking, oh, I should go to Barcelona and perhaps find this guy, but also there was mm-hmm. some kind of mystic around him. And, he died before I got there. But I think, he was in symphony with our times.
Mm-hmm.
He was one more migrant in this world that has many of them. So
So who became much more famous after he died?
Yeah, he became
with many great artists.
Yeah,
is the case. Now, you said about him that he passionately loved writing, and you said about yourself that writing is an inner struggle. Is there also some joy for you in writing?
Oh yeah, lots of joy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not one of those writers who say, "Oh, this is awful and I hate writing." No, this is the thing I love to do. I'm the most alive when I'm writing. It's not easy. You are always questioning yourself.
Mm-hmm.
There are good days and bad days. Financially, it's really not convenient, but mm-hmm. there you are trying to. Trying to do the best you can.
Because what does it give you, the writing? Why do you feel compelled to do so? Yeah. Are you drinking for courage now?
Oh, no, I wish I knew. I wish I knew. I mean, that's one of the questions that's always there. Why am I doing this? Why am I spending my my life doing this, telling stories about people who do not exist. And I really don't know. I don't know, but I need to do it. I love to do it, and I hope I can do it all my all my life. I think that I'm trying to understand myself and understand others, and I'm trying to, I don't know, feel more alive, you know?
Yeah. Is it perhaps imaginable that somewhere young men in their 20s, 18, 19, are reading your books and recognizing themselves and being inspired the way that you were inspired by Bolaño?
You should ask me this question in 20 years.
In 20 years.
Yeah.
But it's possible, right?
Oh, I couldn't say. What I would want to say about Bolaño that, is that he also, he was not afraid of working with his own history and with the stories of his friends and his family and his country. And I think that's also a great lesson, you know, to not be afraid of writing about yourself and about what you know better. Mm-hmm. And of course, it helps to be, to not be in your country.
But why?
Oh, well, at least Cochabamba is a small town. And a lot of friends and family would get really upset if...
If,
I mean, actually, they got a lot of, upset with my books. And they're like, hey, why are you writing about us? And hey, we won't tell you our stories anymore. But I think that it's important when you are writing to forget about everything else. And it's just you and your characters. And your responsibility has to do with your characters and not with not with the people who inspired them.
Yeah. And is it safe to say that Bolaño is the one who... I mean, you were already passionate about writing, but is he the one that really pushed you to dedicate yourself to literature?
He was one of the two or three writers who who let me know, okay, this is what you're really enjoying life and this is what you want to do.
Yeah. And you haven't regretted it since?
No, not yet.
Not yet. And now here you are in The Hague at the Writers Unlimited Festival. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Have a good time at the festival. Thank you.
Thank you. Hey.